Welcome everybody to the third day of the Fish Species Conference 21-21. This is a four-day webinar. We have a session of 2.5 hours. So we also did that yesterday and the day before, and we will do that tomorrow. Today we will have 3 international speakers. We have 3 interviews of people really on the spot. So meaning that if you have joined all sessions, you will hear about 24 projects, and there will be a short discussion, and there will be breakout sessions at the end of today. Today is Europe, so we are focusing on Europe today. And we got speakers from England, Slovakia, Norway, Sweden, and the Netherlands. And you will hear the talk in a minute. You can also participate yourself. You can see and you can listen. You cannot talk yourself, at least not to us via this program, but you can do ask your questions via the Q&A. But before I do that, I'll point you where we are. Today's studio is close to the Haringvliet sluices. And you do not have the beautiful view that I have, but if I look here to my right, I'm looking out of the window and I see the sluices that you can see here on the picture, and more about those today and tomorrow. So for your participation, again, if you have any questions you would like to address to the speakers, then use the Q&A. But if you want to chat about other things with all participants, use the chat function, please. We also have a question manager, that is Ruben van Trijk. He is sitting here next to me, and he will handle your questions in an undoubtedly perfect way. And I think it's time to announce our first guest, if he is already made it online. But before doing so, we're still waiting for him. Please, if you want to spread the news about this conference, use this hashtag, FishSpecies 2021. Hank, is he already in?
Hank is in. I've been listening to you all the time. I was there. Yeah, don't worry.
Okay,
yeah.
Great. Yeah. So welcome, Henk Oving, the Dutch water envoy of the Netherlands. But please, what is a water envoy, Henk?
Thanks so much. A water envoy is indeed an ambassador with a dedicated task to represent water around the world. So that is a real honor, a big challenge, you could say. Because water is so special for everybody, not only for fish migration, but for life. Former Secretary General Ban Ki-moon always said, water is life, and it's connected to everything life has. So it's with biodiversity, with climate, with fish, and so forth. So my role is to advocate for water capacity and awareness, bring forward novel solutions, but also work on water diplomacy in the context where water is very fragile in relationship to climate, migration, conflicts, and so forth. So that is what I do. And I have the honor to be with you. I will address you with a couple of minutes.
Yes, please. And we're especially interested, what is the link between your work and fish passages, of course.
Yeah. So this is, I think, already the third time that I'm part of the fish migration community, and it's a real pleasure and honor. And I have to honor Herman Wanninger, of course, who keeps pulling me in, although I'm confronted with fish migration in my daily work, being it in Asia, Africa, Latin America, or in Europe, but also in the Netherlands. And you already said so, and that we're very close to the Haringvliet sluizen, the sluices that closed off the Haringvliet after 53, when we had our big water disaster in this part of the Netherlands. But closing off a river, or in this case, an inlet, part of a far bigger delta, also brings a lot of challenges, not only for people, but definitely also for the environment. And if you close a river, you more or less kill it. It's like with a dam. It's not only that the water does not flow anymore, but sedimentation stops to flow, and therefore the delta stops to grow. But again, yeah, we're here at this fish migration conference, and fish can't go from one to the other side. So in the context of European agreements, the Netherlands and Germany and other countries, of course, work closely together on biodiversity, water quality, and water safety. And in 2000, we decided to open up again the Haringvliet sluices, to put a crack in it, as we said. There was a formal decision, the crack decision, perhaps the first crack decision in the world, to make sure that saltwater could go back in, that there was a better habitat for fish and others, but also that fish migration could be stimulated. Now, this is a good example, but it was also challenging. This is not done easy. With changing water culture, you change also the use of water. So you have to work with everybody. And I think the crack decision, the Haringvliet sluices, opening them up, showed that the Netherlands has that capacity to work with all layers, from all layers of government, and especially regional water authorities, the province, the municipalities, the drinking water authorities on the ground know the language of the farmers, the citizens, the businesses, to make sure that these decisions are carried through society. Yeah? It's important to ensure that there's trust. Yeah? And I know in my work around the world, working on water security, that building trust and an enabling environment and creating the opportunity to work together are of critical importance and essence of water governance. The other part is learning by doing. What would we know? We build these huge dams to protect us from floods, and at the same time, they challenge our environment and biodiversity. So every step we take, more and more nature-based, are also steps we have to evaluate to be able to validate and scale them up. The Haringvliet sluices crack decision does not stand on itself. We have this big afsluitdijk, the big barrier in the north of the Netherlands that closes off now the IJsselmeer, formerly the Zuiderzee, again, after a big surge in 1916. And when we closed that off again, we closed off more or less a complete habitat system, of course, for our safety and our prosperity, but it's also our responsibility that nature prospers. So in this huge dam, we're also building perhaps one of the biggest fish migration rivers. I think you will be able to see it from the moon. And this is not bigness as to brag about, but this is about the size we need and the scale we need in the interventions we made over time. And again, also the Afsluitdijk is a learning by doing experience that we share with the world. Now, back to the Haringvliet sluizen. Since 2019, we opened them more than 1,000 times to have already millions of fish pass the Haringvliet sluizen. So I think that is an accomplishment in itself. But it does not stand on itself. These interventions that we recover from man-made interventions in the past and reinvent our future in the context of biodiversity loss, environmental challenges, but also climate change, are of critical importance. And the Netherlands, and in my role as a water envoy, I stand for that task to advocate for that awareness and understanding of our vulnerability, but also advocate for these inspiring examples to be able to scale them up and replicate them across Europe and of course across the world. So a conference like this is also a way to bring the fish migration community together and challenge each other and tell our stories to the world outside, that talking about climate change, talking about sustainable development is talking about fish migration and the other way around. So I wish you fantastic conference. You would be more than welcome in the Netherlands and go watch the Haringvliet sluizen and when it's opening up, as well as the new fish migration river that we're building in the Afsluitdijk, and the many, many more water related projects in the Netherlands. After the pandemic, you're happy to visit. We will tour you around. But for now, good luck. fantastic conference, and I hope to hear more from you.
Thank you, Henk, for this great opening of today. I'm afraid we have to leave it here now, just to keep on to the schedule, but thank you for the warm words and also for welcoming all the participants from all over the world to join us in the Netherlands, where a lot of exciting things are happening. Thank you so much, Henk. Then we go to the next speaker. That is Dr. Paul Kemp. Are you there? Hi, Paul.
Hi there, Katja. Good to see you.
Hi. Could you shortly introduce yourself, please?
Well, yes, my name's Paul Kemp. I'm from the University of Southampton, where we have what we call the International Centre for Eco-Hydraulics Research. And there we work on various issues, primarily fish passage, but also habitat restoration and environmental flows. The eco-hydraulics is really an interdisciplinary team, and we really like to try and return to fundamental first principles to solve applied problems.
Okay, thank you. And then the floor is yours for your presentation, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Katja. I hope I'll be able to share the screen. You have to tell me if you can see it.
Yes, I can see it, and you still have to get it full screen.
Hopefully this will work.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much. Thanks for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me to be part of this fantastic Fish Passage webinar of 2021. I was given the task of trying to provide a broad overview of infrastructure issues and fish passage from the European perspective. So what I'm going to try to do in the short time I have available is really talk about how we should perhaps try and advance the sustainability and reduce environmental impacts of infrastructure over its entire lifespan rather than focusing on certain phases of that life cycle. So that's what I'm going to do. Some of the examples I will give will be from other regions of the world, and some of the lessons hopefully we can take away will apply to other regions of the world. But what I like to try and do in a presentation like this is actually ask everybody to take a step back and just to try and remind themselves what it is we're interested in and why are we interested in it. What is the justification for our interests in freshwater ecosystems, in fish passage? And it's a really important question. It's an important thing to justify because we're in a very competitive world. There's a lot of really worthwhile environmental issues, such as the issues of marine microplastics, that gets a huge amount of media attention at this point in time. And we have to compete with these issues in terms to get limited resources. Or why not focus on the terrestrial environment, the clearing and the burning of the Amazon rainforest? Particularly, it's accelerated under Bolsonaro's regime. Isn't this something that we should perhaps be focusing on? Why fish passage? Or maybe it's Greta Thunberg and climate change and the dwindling ice sheets and everything we see about these skinny polar bears in the media and on our TVs. Or maybe it's the unsustainable overharvest of marine fisheries and some really unsustainable practices such as the cutting off of the fins of live sharks so that we can supply the shark fin soup market. I don't think anybody would disagree that every single one of these and many, many more are really worthwhile environmental causes. So where do we fit into this big mosaic of environmental issues and how can we compete for the limited resources in terms of scientific funding and in terms of advocacy to make a difference in this realm? So we have to remind ourselves why fresh waters are important and why fish passage is important. And I think there's two ways, there's two hands, if you like, in terms of how we can look at this. On one hand, we can make a very strong argument and a strong justification for freshwater ecosystems being really degraded and very vulnerable. And there's lots of headline reports, there's lots of taglines we could use to really emphasize this. And I've just picked a few as some examples, but there are many more that you can go and find if you need to make this justification. Some would argue freshwater ecosystems are the most vulnerable ecosystems on the planet. Others say they're among the most degraded and impacted. What we could also argue is that they're hugely exploited for human uses. So nearly 75% of freshwater resources are devoted to agriculture, whether that's arable production or livestock production. And that's only going to increase with an increase in the world population. And it's also going to become even more of an issue when we superimpose the impacts of climate change. We're focusing on fish passage. So of course we have an interest in fish, although arguably it should be wider than that. It should be focusing on aquatic biota and not be so biased on fish. But if we just look at fish, based on more than 5,000 species assessed, then we can consider them to be the most, or at least one of the most, threatened groups of vertebrates. If we look at it from the perspective of those fish that are commercially important, such as the migratory fish, what we can see is a significant decline by over three quarters since the 1970s. And from a UK perspective, we can make the argument that no longer do we have any rivers that are not modified, that are not highly impacted and engineered. We don't have any pristine systems anymore, and they are now highly fragmented and disconnected. So on that one hand, we can make the case that freshwaters are hugely impacted, hugely degraded, and the vertebrates on which they depend are also highly imperiled. On the other hand, is the important point that actually what we have with fish passage and river restoration more generally is a real significant opportunity. And this is all about cost effectiveness. It's about maximizing the bang for the buck. Now this is, I warn you, a slightly dated slide. Now it relates to the UK. The numbers have probably changed somewhat. It's a couple of years old, but it really emphasizes a clear message that I'd like to get across. And that is, of the 7,406 water bodies that were listed in the UK under the Water Framework Directive, the majority of them, 5,000, were failing to meet good ecological status or good ecological potential if they were heavily modified. And the top of that graph illustrates the main primary factor for that, and that was physical modification. That's the engineered structures, that's the dams, the weirs, and the other structures that are placed within the rivers, having this significant impact within those systems. And what we have in Europe is a curse of a long historic legacy of river development through a wide range of activities. A lot of these structures now are sometimes of cultural value, sometimes they're aesthetically pleasing, you might argue. If we go to the city of Bath there in the bottom left-hand photograph, Pulteney Bridge and Weir are very historic sites illustrating this long legacy of development of those rivers. On the right-hand side, you can see a plaque that is placed on the River Itchen in Winchester. And again, it's showing that there's been a mill on that particular site for several hundred years. So we've modified, we've engineered, and we've impacted our rivers in Europe for a long time. The Amber project needs special mention. This is an EU Horizon 2020 funded project involving multiple EU members, EU member states, and it was led by Swansea University in Wales. Carlos Garcia de Linis was the leader of that and did a fantastic job in really raising the issue of infrastructure within European rivers. And for the first time, the Amber project produced the first ever atlas of river infrastructure in European rivers. And what it showed was that there was a huge density of these structures. It was really great in the fact that it used data that was available within the agencies of those respective countries, but it also engaged citizens. And this was the really fantastic legacy of the Amber project, is that there's the citizen engagement using mobile phone apps such as the Tracker app to try and quantify the number of barriers available. And some of the key headlines are that if we take the most conservative number, remember that not every database is perfect, Some databases are very good, but they might not list all types of barriers. In other regions of Europe, you have a relatively impoverished amount of data. But even so, taking the most conservative estimates, we reckon there's 1.2 million in-stream barriers in the 36 European countries that were part of this project. Now, if you calculate the mean density of barriers relative to the river network in Europe, we're looking at 0.74 barriers per kilometre, nearly one barrier per kilometre, and it's likely to be higher than that. But the two really important messages that came from the Amber project is that most of the barriers are small, 68% are less than 2 meters in height, and a large proportion are obsolete, they're derelict, they're redundant, they no longer do the function for which they were originally designed and constructed. And there's our opportunity. We have small barriers, we have lots of them, but often many are redundant. So the opportunity exists, and from a cost benefit analysis perspective, then the removal of barriers can be one of the most effective means of increasing fish productivity and restoring lost habitat. So it's an opportunity when we think about how degraded freshwater ecosystems are, how we might potentially go about trying to improve them in future years. One of the things I'd really like to make a plea to our audience and those involved in fish passage, whether you have a passing interest or whether it's the mainstay of your career, your research, or your activities on a daily basis, is to keep looking out for biases. And some of the biases are very obvious, some are less so. But during the course of this webinar, during the course of the next few weeks and the next year, keep looking out for the biases that there are in fish passage research. For example, how much focus is there on reconnecting the longitudinal connectivity of rivers, the fluvial continuum in the longitudinal dimension? Don't forget, rivers operate in multiple dimensions. They operate longitudinally, laterally, vertically, and of course over time. How much focus is there on these large-scale projects? We've already heard about the Fish Migration River, which is a fantastic project, and I'm not in any way trying to criticize these large-scale projects, but how much focus are we seeing in terms of the literature on the big dams, the big fish passes, when, as I said, from the European perspective, most of the infrastructure is really quite small, less than 2 meters in height? And how much focus is there on a single target species or a limited number of species when really we should be maybe considering a broader fish community and indeed the broader aquatic biota communities? I'd just like to give you a case study example of the importance of lateral connectivity. This is a fish, it's the Burbot lotalota. It's a freshwater member of the cod family, the Gadidae, and from the UK perspective, it's the one species of freshwater fish, solely freshwater fish, that has become extinct over recent times. And the last confirmed sighting was in the UK, was in 1969. And what the Burbot requires, it's a cold water adapted species. It requires good connectivity with the floodplain so that it can enter the backwater channels, the backwater floodplain, and lay its eggs under the cold conditions of January, February, and then have sufficient time there for it to be able for those eggs to develop and for the floods to eventually recede and carry the eggs and the larvae back into the central channel. What we've done over the years, not just in the UK, but throughout Europe and indeed the rest of the world, is heavily engineer and modify our rivers, often for flood defense, so that we lose this lateral connectivity. The map there is of Nottingham. This is some great research that was conducted by one of my former PhD students, Tom Worthington, in which he looked at the historic data of the Burbot stronghold, the former distribution of Burbot in the UK. And what he found is places like Nottingham, this is near Nottingham, that used to be a stronghold for Burbot in terms of the River Trent, have been heavily modified and heavily engineered during the period during which we saw the decline in the Berber. So this is the course of the River Trent now. It runs past Colwick, a water sports centre. And this is a map from 1901 that indicates how much that river has changed in terms of its sinuosity. It's been channelized, it's been dredged, and it's really lost that connectivity with the floodplain that was so important to the Berber's reproduction. This is another map that Tom produced, again showing this change between the current situation, highly channelized, as you can see there, to what the former channel was. And again, there's this associated loss of the floodplain. So when we think about fish passage, we need to be thinking beyond just that longitudinal connectivity. Think about how we might improve connectivity with in the lateral dimension with the floodplain. And one option that's available for us in the UK, but also more widely in Europe, is the use of ecosystem engineers such as the Beaver to enable us to try and restore this lateral connectivity. And this is where we might see a conflict. Beaver are hugely controversial species that are used in restoration. And it's the idea that we're thinking about taking dams out and removing them through the European context. And then we're talking about putting leaky, maybe good dams back in to try and create these riparian corridors that enable that longitudinal connectivity that's been lost for some time to be re-established. So like I say, a very controversial issue, but if they are used, they provide a cheap and self-sustaining form of river restoration in an era where financial resources are limited. What I'd like to do for the last part of this presentation is return to the whole issue of how we should maximize or attempt to maximize sustainability and reduce environmental impacts during the entire lifetime of river infrastructure, from the planning through to the construction and operation, and then ultimately the end of life, the decommissioning. It's really important that we focus on each of these individual stages rather than in a coherent way, rather than any one in turn and in isolation. So if we start off with the start of life, the planning phase, there are various protocols and models that can be used to enable us to do this more effectively. For example, this is some great work by Jesse O'Hanley. Hopefully Jesse might be in the audience today, in which he's been busy working with colleagues in South America, in Brazil, to develop a model using an optimization approach to plan where to put new hydropower infrastructure. Of course, in South America, there's this massive drive for ever more hydropower in places where they're building already some of the biggest dams in the world. And what this model enables us to do is to consider dams as part of a network rather than in isolation. So it can help the planners work out where they're going to get the best cost benefit ratio in terms of the advantages, in terms of the good things that hydropower brings, in terms of improving quality of life by generating electricity for the rural poor people, while at the same time minimizing the environmental impact on the fisheries that also sustain those rural poor people. So what this modeling approach enables us to do is to work out in a network of potentially planned sites where you can place those dams while at the same time minimizing the environmental impact. Likewise, in another situation, again in South America, this is Chile. This is work conducted by Anita Laborde and Evelyn Habit and Oscar Link in the University of Concepcion. Is they're really grappling with the problem of having a large number of fish that have not really been studied from the perspective of fish passage. So they're trying to work out from the very beginning how to minimize the impacts of hydropower on those fish communities. Many of the adult stage of these native fish are less than 15 centimeters in length. So the fish passage technology that we have developed in the northern temperate parts of the world are not necessarily appropriate. So they not only need to develop new fish passage technology, but they also need to work out where and where not to build these dams. And then there are, of course, agent-based or individual-based models that are being used to help us develop more environmentally sustainable ways to either install infrastructure, maybe the building of a new power station, through to the retrofits and modification of that infrastructure. Where should we place the screening systems? Where should we build a new inflow and so on? This is some great work that was conducted by Tom Benson and colleagues at HR Wallingford, along with, in collaboration with the University of Nottingham and Southampton, in which they developed an agent-based model combined with a hydrodynamic model to quantify the potential impacts of a power station on the movements of juvenile European eel. So there's many tools available for us to help us improve the sustainability of our river infrastructure at the planning stage. After that, we have to move into designing fish passes and other environmental mitigation technologies such as screens prior to construction, or retrofit if we have to after construction, and then how we can better operate those systems to minimize environmental impacts. I want to mention the marginal gains concept, but also we need to include design, flexibility, and adaptive management techniques. Many of you will have seen these graphs. These relate to papers that were published nearly a decade ago now, in which there was a sequence of papers that really illustrated that fish passes sometimes don't work very well. And this is now widely recognized. Sometimes they don't work well depending on the type of fish pass, whether we're talking about traction efficiency or passage efficiency. Sometimes they don't work well from the perspective of groups of fish, such as the non-salmonids versus the salmonids. But more importantly is the huge variability of some fishways, in that sometimes they do work well, and in some cases they don't. And why is that? There's a lot of research taking place to try and better understand that. Sometimes it's site-specific, it's context-dependent. In other cases, it relates to the species that we're interested in, it relates to the population, it relates to how motivated those fish might be. It might even relate to the personality of those fish. So there's a lot of research going into the nuance of what causes that variability. But what we must do is not give up. Although we see this high variability, it doesn't mean to say we shouldn't be using fish passage. Indeed, we should. And what we need to be doing is constantly and incrementally improving on that fish passage. And that requires really good science. So I'd like to refer to the marginal gains concept. This is something that was developed very much in elite performance sports. Certainly, I'm proud to say the British Olympic cycling team did really well with the help of the University of Southampton there. If you see the wind tunnel, you'll see the little Southampton, University of Southampton logo in the back. But that is Sir Chris Hoy, who won multiple gold medals in cycling over multiple Olympics. And what they're doing in that wind tunnel is they're redesigning and they're tweaking and they're manipulating the shape of the helmet, the shape of the visor, the shape of the wheels and the shape of the handlebars. And it's based on this principle that small incremental improvements in any process amount to significant improvement when viewed holistically. And it's these little changes that we can apply in fish passage that can make the overall system work effectively. I'm just going to give you a few examples from the fish passage perspective. This is work that was conducted by a former PhD student, Daniela Montali Ashworth. Daniela is a great PhD student, and this is a great PhD, and really it's a hopefully an aspiration for anybody else that's at the start of their PhD right now listening to this presentation. Is what Daniela did is she took a concept which is a very much a fundamental fluid dynamics, fluid structure interactions concept, in that porous cylinders create a longer wake than solid cylinders. And a lot of this work came from those researchers that are looking at aquatic macrophytes and how they operate in riverine environments. So what she did is took this concept of using a cylindrical bristle cluster and applied that to developing a new low-cost fish passage solution for small weirs. Remember the problem that we have in Europe, lots of small structures and therefore we need widespread low-cost solutions to them. And that's Daniela there in the bottom left-hand corner of the screen. And she's quite an interesting individual in the perspective of being somebody that's capable of doing interdisciplinary research. She comes from a civil engineering background, but she has a real interest in the environment. Some might say she's a bit of an eco-warrior. But what she did during her PhD was take this concept, develop a fish pass, and test it in the laboratory with real fish. Then she designed a prototype and took that into the field where we used telemetry to assess how effective it was. And now it is being installed at various sites throughout the United Kingdom. So a good example. Yeah.
Sorry, you are already past your time limit.
Okay. Shall I finish or do you want me to stop now?
Yes. Wrap it up because there's still, thank you.
Okay, very quick. Okay, so there's the examples of Daniela and what she has done with the fish pass. Then we have Matty Deleur, another PhD student, who did a very similar thing with his screening technology where he improved the effectiveness through marginal gains for the physical screen by using acoustics. Another great study that did exactly the same thing from the marginal gains concept. And then finally, Katja, I'm going to finish this presentation by looking at the final stage. And this relates to not only the type of work that Jesse O'Hanley has done for the planning, but also for the change in society that we need to see to make dam removal work. So the dam removal movement in Europe is gaining pace, and I know a lot of people that are involved in this webinar will be very much aware of that. And what we're seeing now is several dams being removed, some of them that are redundant, but not always. Sometimes people are removing dams because they've recognized that the cost benefit of having these dams is not sufficient. It's not good enough in terms of the benefits gained relative to the environmental costs achieved. And with that, I'll now finally finish. I'm sorry for taking extra time, just to say that the lessons that we're learning in Europe can be passed on to other developing regions of the world in Africa, Asia, South America, but likewise, we too can learn from them. So the Sustainable Hydropower for Africa, Asia, and South American Network, the SHASAN Network, has been developed to enable that transfer of knowledge from north to south and south to north, but also from south to south. So if anybody is interested in becoming a participant in this network, and we're going to have a series of webinars soon, the details can be found at the bottom of this slide. And with that, I'll finish. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Paul. It was so interesting. But yeah, we have the other people also waiting for giving presentation. But would you please also share the links within the chat function to the papers that you addressed, so we have some time to read it next week.
I've sent it to Kerry.
Yeah, thank you. Now we have time for one question left. I'm sorry for that. And then it's the question master, Ruben, please.
Thanks, Katja. And thank you from my side, Paul. This was super engaging, and I really could see myself underscoring almost everything you said twice with a red pen. Thank you very much. However, I have some sort of a provocative question, maybe. I hope that's okay. And I like the concept of marginal gains, but I wonder whether it's still appropriate or whether it's even appropriate in the first place when we're talking about things like the biodiversity collapse and the ecological degradation of freshwater ecosystems. Is that still something that we can do and feel comfortable about doing? Or should we say, okay, we throw that concept overboard and really do the big chunk work? Are we too comfortable?
No, we need to consider that concept. We can't remove every dam in Europe. You know, we can't go back. What we have to remember is that we've modified our river systems over centuries. It wasn't all done overnight. And actually, to return it back, if you believe in the rewilding, again, it can't be done overnight. And we haven't got time to wait for the perfect solution before we start implementing other solutions that might maintain gene flow, for example, might maintain populations where they're just hanging on. So we do need to have fish passes that might not be the ideal, but certainly better than they have been. Mm-hmm.
This is obviously something we can discuss a lot about. Maybe we can come back later to that, Katja.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, we have to wrap it up, Paul. But there will be the at the end of this session. So
thank you very much.
We will ask some other questions to you. Thank you, Paul, for your contribution, and see you later this afternoon.
Thank you.
Okay, and then we fly to Slovakia, and we will meet Miro Odzalik. Are you there, Miro? Hi.
Hello. Greetings from Slovakia. I hope that you can hear me well, because I'm standing directly in the river.
Yes. Yeah. We have some picture. There's a live interview. First fly to your place, so everybody knows where you are standing, Miro.
Okay. So how it is going with the conference?
Yeah, that's going fine. But this is our real life in the field first today. So really looking forward to the interview with you.
Okay, nice. So,
wait a minute. So this is what you made for us this morning at 9 o'clock?
Yeah. The removal work start in the morning, and for now the works are halted and will continue tomorrow, and till Friday the whale should be removed. Also, as you can see, this is the Hučava River. It's a very beautiful and natural river. It springs in the Polana biosphere reserve, and after 30 kilometers it flow into Zolna River. What is interesting that we can find here up to 7 fish species, including protected Barbus carpaticus, which was found under the barrier. So it's definitely a barrier for them to spawn downstream, so upstream. So this will help also for these protected fish.
And you're removing the dam, but that will open up things. But if I remember correctly, you managed to get this done by means of crowdfunding.
Yes. Definitely. This project or this campaign was founded with the great support of a crowdfunding platform, Remove the Dams in Europe, set by WWF Netherlands. This platform is supporting many campaigns and projects across the whole Europe. Already several dams and barriers were removed in Spain, France, United Kingdom, or in Ukraine. So, great effort and great platform.
And you said, what is so particular about the place that you are standing? What is why did you start with this one?
Yeah, why we choose this particular barrier for removal? We are working on dam removal for several years in WW Slovakia, and this barrier was chosen by the also with the cooperation with water authority. As I said, many interesting and protected species live in the Hučava River. Also, when we looked at the river basin management plan, so this water body is not achieving a good ecological status. So this kind of measure will improve the ecological quality or the status of the water.
Okay, and are the people on the background, are these locals or are these scientists?
No, they're just my co-workers with me. as I said, the work started in the morning and just for now are stopped and will continue tomorrow. So,
okay. And do you have any plans for monitoring once the dam is removed to see what the impact is? Mm-hmm.
We did an ichthyological monitoring or ichthyological survey. And after that, after removal will be done again. So we will see the effectiveness of these measures. As we always said, removal is the best option or best measure for improving or restoring the river continuity.
Great. And do you already have a next one in mind that you want to remove?
Yeah. As I said already, we working on it already. So we choose two another barriers. So we are working right now on the technical documentations and on the permits and approvals.
Great. Okay. Thank you so much, Miro. We have to wrap it up here, but thank you for being here live. And we continue with the conference and good luck with the good work.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay, and then it's time for the commercial break. You will see some ads by the sponsors, and we're very grateful to the sponsors because without the sponsors, there would not have been a webinar. Would you like to find more out about the things that are being shown? Please check the website. See you in a minute. Bye.
It's well known that man-made structures on rivers can impede the movement and migration of fish. So studying how fish behave around dams and other facilities is vital to understanding the impact of these structures. However, these studies are extremely challenging and complex. That's where InnovaSea comes in. Using our innovative fish tracking technology, our experts can handle every aspect of a research project to help companies meet their regulatory requirements. Get in touch with us today to learn more.
Eel is a species synonymous with our inland waterways, yet numbers have decreased drastically. Fish migration is crucial for the life cycle of eel. We have developed a monitoring device for glass eels and elfers called ELFI. ELFI has already proven itself as a successful monitoring device at more than 35 locations. Monitoring with ELFI is cost-efficient and active 24/7. This standardized monitoring enables identification of trends and changes.
Welcome back. The next presentation will be by Anna Silva, and I already saw her in the, Anna, hi Anna.
Hi.
So you are at NINA in Norway, but you started in Lisbon working on forestries.
Yes, that's true.
So that is great. And what does NINA stands for?
It's the Norwegian Institute for Nature Research. Yeah.
Okay. And you are a research scientist. So there is a department working on fish, or?
Yeah, the aquatic department of NINA, exactly.
Oh, okay, okay.
The biodiversity part. Yeah.
Okay, great. So you will tell us more about fish locomotion and hydropower. So really looking forward to it, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Katja. I'll try to share my screen here. Let's see if this will work. Okay, can you see it?
Yes, and you still have to enlarge it. Put it in the presentation mode.
Let's see. All right. Yeah, it's good.
Yes, it is.
Perfect.
Good luck.
Okay, so yeah, good afternoon to everybody. I would like to start by thanking the invitation to the organization team of the Fish Passes 2021 to invite me to be here today and to participate in this really exciting webinar. It's been very interesting. And I have to say that I really like all these very dynamic and interactive interviews that we have here. It's really amazing. So I was asked to talk a little bit about fish locomotion and hydropower. It's usually two words that they really don't see it like together, but I'll try my best here. And the idea is like to explain how we can use the knowledge about fish locomotion in an applied situation and to help in terms of conservation. So I'll start in a very similar way that Paul Kemp start, and trying to stress again that freshwater fish species are in decline. And that's a very important issue. And like he presented before, there's definitely a decline of around 76% of the freshwater fish population since 1997 and 2016. And that is like a very high rate, in fact, higher than the decline that both the marine and terrestrial migratory species together. So, and why does that happen? It has happened for many different reasons, including overfishing, climate change, and also like the construction of anthropogenic structures in the freshwater aquatic systems. So there is a need for the development of new solutions that will help to mitigate the impact of these anthropogenic structures on fish population. And especially now, and why especially now? Because there are actually political goals to increase the production of the renewable energy. And there are like different ambitions, environmental goals for water bodies in different directives. In Europe, for instance, the Water Frame Directive. And there's also plans for new hydropower and rehabilitation and expansion of existing installations. So there's like a strong need for trying to mitigate this impact. And then that goes to the question, so how does understanding fish locomotion and their interplay with the fluid and hydrodynamics of the flow can help to mitigate the impact of those anthropogenic structures and can also help in terms of fish conservation? And here in fish conservation, I also like to add also other type of biota that we can find in the freshwater aquatic systems. So let's look into the interaction of fish with the fluid dynamics in nature. And to try to understand a little bit more the theoretical part on the terms of biomechanics and fluid dynamics and how to combine that, I'll ask you to put yourself a little bit on the role of a fish. Try to feel like a fish, try to think like a fish. Imagine that you are in a swimming pool and you try to dive and sink and sit in a swimming pool. And immediately you'll start to feel all of these forces like pulling it up or like pulling backwards or upwards. Like you will start to experience imbalance because you are an object embedded in the fluid, in the water. And that's exactly what fish experience as well. So Immediately you'll start to move your arms, your legs, your hands to try to keep this balance and all your entire body. And this is exactly the same that fish do it. And you do that when you're trying to hold your position in the swimming pool, in the bottom of the swimming pool, or when you're trying to swim and move forward. And that's also the type of interaction that the fish does with fluids, in this case, in the water. So fish, they use their body and the different appendages, the pectoral fins, the dorsal fins, the tail, etc. They move their body in different positions. And all of that will determine their behavior, their swimming speed, their swimming orientation, and ultimately their fish migration route, their trajectory. So, but all of this, it varies from, it's based on the interaction of the fish and the fluid, and therefore it varies according to the different morphometrics of the fish. So different species, they react differently, or they use the different appendages to swim or to hold position or to change or also to keep their balance and stability. And there's not only a variation among species, but also within species, like within like different life stages. So how do fish are able to sense all these variations on the fluid around them? They can do it by using this sensory system that's composed by inner ear and the superficial and canal nerve mass. And this superficial and canal nerve mass, they do exist. There's like this structure, these cells, that they do exist in under the skin and at the surface of the skin of the fish, like through all the body of the fish. And the number of these structures varies from species to species. So this allows the fish to feel all these variations of the flow along the entire body. And that will contribute and that will determine its reaction. So which hydrodynamic variables influence like fish behavior and swimming performance? Like which, these hydrodynamic variables are usually known more as hydraulic variables. So which are the parameters, the variables that the fish can sense and make them to react, make them to have different behaviors? Before looking at those variables, I would like you to keep in mind that fish, they always adopt strategies to reduce the energetic cost associated to any type of activity. So fish, they, for instance, if we think about migration, that is something that's been very discussed here in this webinar. Fish, they can migrate for different purpose, either for spawning or for feeding or to seek for different refuse or habitats. And they always try to minimize the energetic cost associated to the swimming. And that's what I would like you to keep in mind. So there's been like different studies, mainly developed under laboratory conditions, where we have been trying to understand which variables impact fish swimming capacity and orientation and speed. And there's three main hydraulic variables that have been showing to impact fish the most: water velocity, acceleration, and turbulence. So let's look into water velocities. There have been several studies focused on the relation between water velocity and fish. And we have seen, or some colleagues have shown, that the increment of velocity will also increase the consumption of oxygen. And this means like a higher energetic cost associated to the swim of the fish. So fish automatically trying to create like a strategy to cope with such big water velocities. And naturally they will try to avoid areas of big water velocities. So basically it's what they do in general. In terms of acceleration, they have a similar behavior. Like her colleague Eva Anders, she showed that like salmon smolts, for instance, they change their real taxis orientations when they can feel the acceleration fields. So again, they try to avoid areas where there's a big fluctuation in terms of velocity. So now let's look a little bit into turbulence. Turbulence is a complex phenomenon, and turbulence results from the flow interacting with different structures, the bottom topography, banks, or also rocks. So when we all look to rivers, we are very used to see and immediately say like, oh, that's a very turbulent area, or it's not so turbulent. And what we're doing, you know, we're like analyzing and we're like having the perception of all these unsteady flows and very chaotic flows. And that's kind of what we define as turbulence. And like us, fish can also feel these variations and these chaotic areas. But sometimes we just look and we can visualize what we say, oh, this is a very calm area, but we are a little bit wrong, as there are also these microscale variations on the flow that create also turbulence in the fish. They can perceive such variations. So even if you cannot see them, they are there. So like I said, turbulence is a complex phenomenon and is characterized for different parameters. And that means like some turbulence that they've been identified as very relevant for fish swimming performance. And like the first ones that I will mention here, like eddies, eddy size and vorticity. On this figure, I illustrate one of the first kind of drafts of identifying this type of structures by Leonardo da Vinci, where it just drew like these different eddies caused by the presence of an obstacle in water. We also have like turbulence intensity, turbulence kinetic energy, and granular shear stress that have also been shown as very relevant parameters for fish. I'll talk about them a little bit later. So let's focus a little bit on the eddies. Like I said, turbulence is also created by the presence of like obstacles, like a rock. And to have a better idea what the eddy is, like imagine a rock, and then all of these recirculation areas you can see from the rock, like downstream of the rock. So those eddies and those recirculatory areas, they have some energy associated. And fish can use such energy to move. So there's like this interplay between fish and fluid. And then there's also like a strategy that's adopted for fish by fish to either move with the flow or leaving certain areas. So, but it's not only with the eddies, or fish don't only use these eddies created by rocks or logs or things that exist in a river, but when we are looking like to a school, the fish per se will induce to these eddies to create these structures. And the fish will use that again, that energy, to move forward and to minimize the energetic cost. And that's also works as a signal of where the fish is, the front fish is. And that is similar to what we see to birds. Like if we see like birds migrating, you usually see a leader. And what this leader is doing is giving like cues, like and partly aerodynamic cues that the birds that are behind can use to navigate. And at the same time, to decrease their energetic cost associated to flying. So eddies influence fish swimming, swimming speed, swimming orientation, swimming stability, and posture. And it depends on the eddy size and relative to the fish size, and also depends on the frequency and periodicity of that eddy. So eddies can affect or help fish swimming. It depending on their relation in terms of size with the size of the fish. So if they're smaller than the fish, they can help fish because the fish can use the energy associated to the rotation of the eddy. And if they are bigger than 0.5 or 0.6 of the total length of the fish, then we'll induce to some problems in terms of controlling posture and stability. Again, we'll have some energy expenditures associated to this process. And ultimately will also influence like swimming performance. So let's look now to the influence of turbulent intensity and kinetic energy. Similar to what happened in, with water velocity and acceleration, fish also try to avoid areas with very high turbulent intensity or turbulent kinetic energy. And the same happens when we look to shear stress, that is also one of the parameters of turbulence, the characterized turbulence. And they try to avoid these areas because it's caused some more, it's more difficult for fish to swim in areas with very high renal shear stress. And such tension can also induce to injuries or even when in very high levels, the mortality of the fish. So as a summary, like fish tend to avoid high levels of turbulence. And of course, I'm saying this, this is like the generic aspect because then it, it gets a little bit more complex when you go for different species, different types of different parts of life stage. For instance, like salmon, when they are spawning, when they're doing their migration to spawning, they are attracted partly by turbulence because the places for spawning are characterized by some more turbulence and high velocities. What is a little bit different from what I'm saying here, but when they're like in general moving, then they do try to avoid such areas. So going back, turbulence can also challenge control and body posture. Fish swimming performance is reduced by these higher turbulence intensities, and turbulent flows, they do increase oxygen consumption. And there's this relation between the length of the fish and the length of the eddy. Fish can use energy associated to small eddies and reduce the cost of locomotion. And fish avoid areas with also higher renal shear stress. And again, turbulent can then challenge swimming trajectories and routes. So this is the theoretical part, the fundamental part. But how can we use this to create new solutions that will facilitate like both up and downstream migration of fish and minimize the impact of these anthropogenic structures that more and more exist in the rivers? So like I mentioned, most of these results were collected under laboratory conditions that are very different from the nature. So sometimes, like when we bring this theory to the field, to practice, is slightly a little bit different. So let me make like a summary of what I've said so far. So basically we have the fish swimming. They will find some perturbations in the system, and they can either natural perturbations or caused by anthropogenic structures. They can feel those modifications in terms of those variations in the fluid, and they can percept that, and they will react, and they can move their orientations, they can start swimming faster, they can change paths, etc. So basically, this will have like a big importance for where they go, for their migratory route, what happens when they encounter this type of obstacles. So I'm going now to show you one of the projects that we developed here in Norway, where we basically used all this theoretical part to try to come up with a solution for the downstream migration of Atlantic salmon smolt. So this was a project that was conducted in Mandal River. Mandal River is located in south of Norway. And this river is considered one of the rivers with the highest production of salmon in Norway. But in this same river, there are located six different hydropower plants, and including one of them, the Laudrup plant, it's located exactly on the migratory path of the smolt. So we were trying to understand how do salmon smolt behave at the vicinity of that hydropower plant, and what happened, and what could be the causes related to the different variations in terms of the different paths of this different salmon. So for that, so here on the left side, I think you can see my screen, my mouse here. So this is the intake of the other power plant. This was our area in dots, like was our area of research, basically. And then downstream, 500 meters downstream, you will find a weird with a fish passes in the center. So the idea is that the fish will approach and will pass the intake area and continue their movement downstream and have a safe migratory route to the sea. So for that, we use some 2 and 3D acoustic telemetry. We deployed like 14 hydrophones and we tagged 92 salmon smolts. We start to analyze where the smolts were going, like a very simple question. And we understood that the fish final destination was very much related with the location of approach. And based on that, and based on the fact that we know that there's like a strong influence of hydraulics and hydrodynamics on fish behavior, fish swimming performance or orientation, then we tried to go a little bit further and try to understand if there is an influence of such hydrodynamics on the route of the fish in front of this hydropower plant. So based on the data, biological data that we acquired by the acoustic telemetry, and also based in the information of hydrodynamics that we got by going to the field, doing some ADCP measures, and also to do some CFD modeling, we tried to combine both the biological and hydraulic data and come up with a model for swimming direction and for swimming speed that was in function of hydraulics. So what we found was that both swimming speed and the direction of the fish do depend on the magnitude and direction of velocity and turbulence, and they are related with the fish swimming capacity mode. We also found that fish diverge from the flow at speeds higher than their sustained swimming speed, and that they usually go with the flow when water velocities are above 0.5 meters per second. And that we found the direction of the flow strongly influenced fish swimming behavior. So these are kind of some of the very simple results that we found, and I put it here, but it was a little bit more complex once that we analyzed all the interactions between velocity and turbulence. But if you want, you can learn a little bit more on that on our paper. So after that, our main goal was, okay, so now how are we going to use all of this information to help fish to move downstream in a safe way without end up going to the turbines? Because that was the main purpose of the project. And what we did, we tried to come up with a structure that will help fish to move downstream. And again, we did some CFD modeling, some numerical modeling, to try to understand better in terms of the flow and the areas where the flow will diverge and the areas where flow will go to intakes and et cetera. And we developed a structure. We developed a structure that is now implemented in the field in that river. And this structure was based in a modified angle bar rack design that was developed for our colleagues from ETH Zurich, with who we work close. And this is a very long structure with approximately 85 meters, with 1.5 meters depth. And each panel is about 10 meters. So we have like different panels that are set together. And this bar, so the bar space, the space between bars is of 50 millimeters. And the idea here is not so much that the fish cannot pass the bars, but trying to make that the hydrodynamics in front of those bars will be ideally to make the fish, to guide the fish to the opposite bank of the river where the intake is. Because as I showed before, we understood that if the fish were going through the bank opposite to the intake, then they could move safely downstream. again, like, because their destination was very much related with the location of approach. So, and that's what we're trying to do here. So this is like a detail of the bars. And again, we're trying to create like velocities that will allow fish to move towards the opposite bank of where the intake is, and also by using these different circulations. This is another image of the structure here, like you have a better perspective of the dimension of the structure. We are currently now testing the structure. We have like, again, a 3D acoustic telemetry setup that we're going to retrieve next week. So hopefully we'll have some very interesting data we think that we'll have, because we also have some data in terms of hydraulics and the hydrodynamics in front of the bars. They match exactly to what we were expecting. So we hope things will work, but we'll learn more about it in a couple of weeks. But this was basically,
You're also running out of time.
Okay, I'll just wrap up this in another two slides and it's done. Thanks. So basically this was constructed based on the idea of giving these velocities and provide this acceleration so the fish could move in parallel to the structure. But we try to go a little bit further, and we have now a new project that's based on the using turbulent eddies to create paths for safe downstream migration for salmonids and eels past hydropower intakes. The project starts this year and goes until 2026. And here the idea is really to create these eddies and eddy paths that the fish can use or they can avoid. And that's something that we're going to study better. And then to guide them to where we want, either to a bypass or to another side of the river, like I showed before. So to finalize, I would just like to say that it is important to know and to understand fish interaction with hydrodynamics of the flow. It is not just a fundamental part of science, it's not just a theoretical thing, it's something that we really need to apply and to be able to both improve the future river management and also to develop new engineering solutions for safe fish migration, and therefore to help for fish conservation. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna, for this great talk. I'm not sure if I'm already visible. Yeah. No, Ruben is. Yeah, okay. Thank you, Anna. And this bringing the theory about turbulence into practice, I think it's amazing. I have many questions myself, but I'll leave it to the question master, Ruben.
Thank you, Katja. and thank you, Anna. Nice to see you again, all by the digital format. there's a question from the audience. It's long, so I'm just going to read it out loud. In an evolutionary sense, the morphometric characteristics of a fish will be determined in part by its preferred habitat and hence limit in its ability in its life history to reduce energy expenditure when hydrological characteristics of the area change due to anthropogenic impacts. That's the question.
I'm not sure if I understood the question. Okay, if I think that will be such an evolution variation.
In the evolutionary sense, the morphometric characteristics of a fish will be determined in part by its preferred habitat and hence limit its ability in its life history to reduce energy expenditure when hydrological characteristics of the area change due to anthropogenic impacts. So this is a two-part question. So the first part is about the morphometric characteristics of a fish and its life history that is determined by the environment. And then it connects to the second part that says it limits its ability to reduce energy expenditure when hydrological characteristics of the area change due to anthropogenic impacts?
I'll try my best to answer you. I'm not
really sure. I think the question is if do fish change in the morphometrics and in the behavior due to our doing?
I think there are two different things, but in terms of the evolutionary aspect, I know there has been studies that they've been showing like in some variations in terms of population due to impact of the presence of different anthropogenic barriers. And also in terms of variation of habitat, there's been some studies in terms of DNA that have been showing that. In terms of morphometrics, I would say it's a little bit more difficult. I do know that there's like more aspects in terms of adaptation, in terms of habitat suitability and also adaptation to use the new habitats, for instance, for spawning or etc. And that can be also like a problem because some fish, they assume this new habitat as the suitable habitat or the new habitat, right? And if we'll change that, that can create some repercussions in that population. So I don't know if that really answered the question, but in one way it's like, yes, there can be some variations and they've been showing that if they're not evolutionary context, they do exist. And in terms of mathematics, I would say so far that I know there's not so many studies on that. I know there's like this variation in terms of habitat and adaptation. So
I guess, Katja, if we just ask Levelin, the lady or gentleman who asked the question, to clarify in the chat whether the question has been asked, maybe that helps. Also, a quick reminder, we said it many times, we have to emphasize it again. If you have questions, don't ask them in the chat function. They will get lost at some point. We get many questions in. Please refer to the question and answer function. Otherwise, we will miss them and direct them to the person you are asking them.
Thank you, Ruben. Yeah, thank you, Ruben, thanks for the reminder. Thank you, Anna. We will see you back in the panel later on, eh?
Okay.
And then we can ask more questions. Thank you for your contribution. Great, thank you. And then we go from Norway to Sweden. And then we meet Johan. Johan, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me, Katja?
Yeah, I can hear you, Johan. Welcome, welcome. Great. So thanks. You are from the Umeå University in Sweden.
Yes, that's right. I'm a PhD student at Umeå University, soon to finish.
Okay, and tell us, yeah, we first zoom in where we are on the globe.
That's, yeah.
We are zooming in. Yeah.
That's the correct position.
Norfors. So what do we see behind you, Johan?
You see a part of the single largest hydropower plant in Sweden. So you can see maybe a massive concrete wall up there and a tiny bit of water running behind me. So right now I'm looking at the beginning of the salmon migration season, and I've seen a few salmon pass by already when I'm standing here. This power station, as I said in my title for this interview, we managed to combine like a large scale hydropower and also a lot of salmon passing by. And I should reveal straight away that was kind of a clickbait title, because the answer to how to combine those two is you need like another river next to the regulated one. So where I'm at right now, this is the lower reach of Ume River, and this river actually consists of two major rivers. So one is totally regulated, but the other one is pristine and one of Sweden's national river saved from hydropower. But the river junction of these two big rivers are upstream of this giant barrier. So all the salmon, the wild salmon that spawn in the unregulated river, they still have to pass this one giant hydropower station. And that's possible by a long fishway. It's a combination.
Exactly, the fishway, yeah.
Yeah, it's a combination of 8 kilometer long natural bypass, which is the original river stretch that leads up to this point where I'm standing. And then to get past this concrete dam, we have a technical fishway, a ice harbor fishway, 350 meters long, to get them above the last 22 or 23 meter of height difference to reach the other side of the dam.
And do they swim that height, or how does it work, the last part?
Yeah, that height difference is 22 meters spread out over 350 meters long. So you have these lots of compartments where they can get up.
Yeah. And there is also, I've heard something about a bubble barrier.
Yeah. So in my PhD, I've been looking at the downstream migration. So now I'm presenting the upstream migration, but I'm focused on how to get down after spawning, and also for the smolt migration. So at the other end of this barrier or this dam, there's a physical guidance structure similar to the one that Anna just presented, actually. Mm-hmm. And I compared those physical structures with bubble barriers, which is kind of a non-conventional way to guide migrating fish. So that's what I've been focusing on.
I'm also asking the question because there are some ideas to incorporate. Sorry for this.
Who's calling?
Yeah, someone was calling me. But there are some ideas of introducing bubble barriers to catch plastics floating on the river. But do you think they might also stop migratory fish?
Yes, I do, actually. Or not stop completely, but at least guide them and change their swimming behavior, definitely. We have results both from lab and also field studies from this site showing that at least up to quite moderate water velocities, 0.3 meters, stop and do like a 90 degree turn to swim to the side. So I've been in contact with that. I think it's a Dutch company that wants to divert plastics, and it definitely affects fish movement as well.
Okay, thank you. And when will be the peak in salmon, because you said you just saw a few?
I think it will peak some mid-July, maybe, in this river here. And usually we have up to 10,000 adult salmon migrating upstream. So we're fingers crossed for a good migration season.
Okay, we also have our fingers crossed here then. So thank you, Johan, for your contribution, and good luck with the research.
Thank you, Katja. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, and now we have some time for the poll, and I leave it again to our quiz master, who, to no one's surprise, is Ruben.
Thank you, Katja. All right, I hope I need to start sharing my screen now. I hope it's going to work smoothly. You should see the link to the poll, including the code, in the chat window by now. Please go to menti.com and enter the code 22700699 to participate. Everyone go to Menti right now and we can start this. The first question that we're asking is something we asked in the last 2 days as well. It is, what is your favorite measure to restore river connectivity? What is yours, Katja?
I cannot say that because I might be influencing them.
Well, you could name one that's not on the
Ooh,
screen.
Ooh, right, okay, now. Then the fish migration river.
Okay, mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that one too. Yeah, how far is it along?
Yeah, a bit. There will be after the webinar, there will be these meetings, and then there will be pictures shown that were taken last week or so.
Fantastic! I can't.
Yeah, but it's really starting to make a hole in the in the dark. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got barrier removal going here. Dam removal in the two first prominent places. Not super surprising. This was the same yesterday and the day before. Removal, dam removal, barrier removal. We have fish pass there. Floodplain reconnection. Nice to see that on the list. What else have we got here? 61 participants. Technical fish passages here. Barrier and dam removal keep on the top. We don't have a whole lot of time, so I don't know, Katja, maybe we should stop and turn to the next question.
Yeah, when we do. Reach like we do. 80 we have a couple participants. Of
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, we're at 75, so five more participants, five more voters, then we can go to the second question.
One time, two times.
Four more. Barrier removal are still there. Dam removal right there at the top. Fish passage, 279 participants and 81. So maybe we should go to number two.
Yeah. Because then we.
So thanks for that.
Need a small break.
Yeah. Right. The second one is this one: a restoration plan for river connectivity should always be looked upon from a sea to source perspective. You may fully disagree. You may somewhat disagree. You maybe don't know. You may somewhat agree, and you may fully agree. And we have 17 participants in. Most of the participants fully agree, 51% right now, 54% somewhat disagree is the second strongest bar. That's interesting. Oh, now it's overtaken by the somewhat agree bar with 26% in yellow here on the right side. 1% 1% doesn't know. 10% fully disagree. This is interesting stuff, Katja. Maybe we have time to discuss that later again.
With the during the panel discussion. Wonderful. Later on. And I don't know, they have to read the book, of course, by Hermann.
That's true. There's the C2 Source 2.0 book. It's free for download. You can also buy a copy, I believe. 9% fully disagree. Now we have 100 participants, so 9 people fully disagree with that statement. I would really like to know why.
We will do that later, but we have a third question or not?
Oh yeah, we do have a third question.
Okay, and then we do the third
100
question.
Or 103 participant. Let's switch to the third. Do you know the share of fishways in your country or region? Whatever you can best associate with that work as per design specification. Some of you might not know, some may know it's less than 10% or more than 10 to 33%, more than 33 to 66 or more than 66%. Most of us don't know. We have 65, well, the numbers are coming in. The votes are coming in hot. 75 people have voted, 77, 80, 70% almost don't know. This is a problem, I believe. This is very important intel that we're getting right now.
Absolutely.
More than 10% to 33% is the second highest bar, 15%. So almost 15 votes.
And we stop at 100.
Let's stop at 100. Oh, we are there.
Yeah, okay. We are there. Okay.
I guess you can still keep voting even if we stop the results here, and we can come back to that later, right?
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Okay, then let's keep it like that, and we're gonna go back to that later. Thank you.
Okay, this means that we do have a 2-minute break, and I see you within 2 minutes for the next presentation.
Thank you. No sound.
Aha, welcome back. Now, yeah, thank you. The next presentation is by two persons. So it's by Mark and by Wilco. Let's first go to Mark.
Hello.
Hi, Mark. Hi. So please, could you introduce yourself? I already see CDM Smith with his a clue.
Yeah. It's just a background picture, but I'm in the office. So yes,
oh, you are.
I'm Mark Redeker. I'm a trained sort of civil engineer specialized in water and hydraulic engineering, but been with Fish Passage basically the whole of my lifetime. Did my degree on a rock ramp fishway at the time. That was 25 years ago. And I've been working on Fish Passage issues ever since, basically.
Okay, thank you. And is Wilco also visible or not?
Yes, I am.
Hey, Wilco.
Hey. Hi, thank you.
Shortly introduce yourself, please, Wilco.
Yes. Yeah, my name is Wilco de Bruyne. I'm an aquatic ecologist from the Netherlands. I'm currently working at O Consultants, a small environmental consultancy, and Mark and I are former colleagues. So we work together on several fish migration projects internationally. So that's how we know each other and still working together on fish migration.
Okay, thank you, Wilco. And if I understand it correctly, Mark will start with the presentation.
Yeah.
Okay, Mark, the floor is yours.
Okay, so just give me a feedback if you can. Oops, something has happened.
Yeah, and just put it on the presentation mode.
Yeah, is it?
Yeah, perfect. Yeah,
cool.
Thank you.
Okay, so yeah, I'll jump right into it because we're somewhat strapped for time. So basically, Wilco and I will be outlining three super interesting fish passage restoration projects on three European rivers. You'll see they're in different stages of the implementation, but what they have in common, they're the lowermost barriers in their river basins. Wilco will be talking on the Fish Migration River, which we've heard quite a bit about now, and also on Kier Harding Fleets. And I will be starting with the Iron Gate Dams. So the Iron Gate Dams on the Danube River, and we've been working since 2018 with a number of international partners, which I would like to acknowledge here. And just to sort of an introduction, just a short sort of presentation of the Danube River Basin, which is actually the most international river basin in the world. It covers 10% of continental Europe and extends into the territories of 19 countries. The Danube River Basin is home to about 2,000 plants and 5,000 animal species, but it also sort of includes several sort of endangered species. The fish population comprises 135 species of formerly six native sturgeon, and sturgeon are actually the flagship species of the Danube River Basin. The status of the Danube sturgeon is all but good. There's three species which are basically extinct or which have only been observed in single numbers. The numbers of beluga sturgeon and stellate sturgeon are sort of rapidly declining, and the sterlet is also threatened. The protection and conservation of the Danube sturgeon has been on the agenda for over a decade now, and the objectives and the measures are embedded into different strategies and plans, both on a catchment level and a European level. And these goals and activities feed into the Danube River Basin Management Plan. The conservation objectives also align well with the long-term EU biodiversity strategy to protect nature. And there's also several sturgeon projects ongoing or finalized, and the International Protection Commission for the Protection of the Danube River Basin basically never sort of gets tired of promoting these activities. So this is the currently, the recently updated map for the 2021 Danube River Basin Management Plan. It actually shows the prioritization of river continuity measures. And you can see two fat dots here, and these symbolize the measures of utmost priorities, and these are the Iron Gate Dams. So the largest dam on the Danube was built or completed in 1972 on the downstream end of the Iron Gate Gorge. And this is why it's called Iron Gate One. Maximum head is 28 meters and the capacity of the hydropower plant exceeds 10,000 cubic meters per second. Iron Gates 2 was completed in 1984, about 80 kilometers downstream. It is not as high as the Iron Gate 1, but basically what it did, it impounded the Danube River right up to the Iron Gate 1 dam, and it basically created a huge big reservoir. So both dams sit on the border of Romania and Serbia, and the countries share the hydropower generation. The covers, basically the output, the generation covers 13% of the country's use in Romania and 23% in Serbia. So these are really important generation assets. But what has happened is that basically downstream of the Iron Gate dams, the Danube flows freely for 862 kilometers into the Black Sea. But the Iron Gates have actually cut off the access into the basically into the middle and upper reaches of the river basin. So on the main stem, the next barrier upstream is Gapshikovo, is about 10,000 kilometers away. So restoring fish passage at the Iron Gates is really, really essential to enable access to habitats and spawning grounds in the on the main river, but also the main tributaries in the middle basin. In recent years, first steps have actually been taken to address fish passage at the Iron Gates. And the first activity was a scope emission in 2011. In 2013, Vilcor initiated a sort of a more in-depth assessment of possibilities to restore fish passage at the Iron Gate dams. And that actually included some fish telemetry of sturgeon downstream of Iron Gates 2. On the right-hand side, you can see a beluga sturgeon that was caught below Iron Gates 2 and was tracked for about a week during that project. We also developed some initial fish pass concepts just to illustrate the size and the footprint of appropriate solutions. And this figure shows a pool-type fish pass. It's 112 pools. It's got three entrances, an auxiliary attraction flow structure, and the length would be about a 1 kilometer, basically bypassing the existing infrastructure there. In 2014 and 15, further work was done on fish movement monitoring just to improve the telemetry methods and the protocols. So the WePass project is the ongoing project until November this year. And basically what WePass is, it's the preparatory phase of a full-scale feasibility study on fish migration on the Iron Gates. And the activities include an analysis of the current situation, basically, especially sort of the structures, their modes of operation, river hydrology, water management, so the water level management. We're also processing old as-built drawings and establishing a 3D computer-aided design model that will be used for engineering designs. A literature study on sturgeon migration behavior and fishways was also completed, and as further fish movement tracking is being done, and I'll show you some results in a minute. We're going to carry out a sturgeon experts meeting just to reflect on our work and discuss aspects that we want to take forward. And we've updated the roadmap and the whole of the activities are framed with project communication. So here's the result of the autumn 2019 fish tracking. So the map on the left basically shows the locations of the receivers and the fish release sites around Iron Gates 2 and in the reservoir. In total, 61 fish were tagged with acoustic tags. 21 fish were actually released upstream. We saw two actually move downstream. We don't know how where they went. But also 40 fish were released downstream. And it was really interesting to see that they not only move upstream to the main hydropower plant, which is on the Romanian side, but they also move to the right side of the river to the Serbian secondary hydropower plant, which has only got two turbines. So you see a nice distribution there. This slide just gives you some impressions of the model, the 3D model that we are establishing. That basically includes the structure, a terrain model, the subsurface model, so the geology that we need for engineering, and the river bathymetry that can be used for some hydraulic modeling in the next project stages. The 2 months ago, the European Commission basically commissioned the subsequent feasibility study, and the work on the next project phases are actually, or packages is actually started. The work ahead of us in the next 3 years will involve a more detailed movement study at Iron Gates 2 and in the reservoir using 3D fish telemetry technology, just to identify the areas where the fish really congregate, so where fish pass entrances need to be located. Fish hazard or a turbine model will ascertain what target species and what size and age stages we need to protect during downstream migration. We'll be investigating options to establish up and downstream fish migrations at both Iron Gate dams using 2D modeling, but also combining that with 3D tracks. The identified solutions for those will be developing preliminary designs. We'll be using 3D hydraulic modeling for that. And the cost estimate is really important to actually progress investment and funding of the project. So in brief, the setting at the Iron Gates is really, really challenging with regards to the river scale, the dimension, the arrangement of the camp complexes. It's on two borders, which makes it highly political. There's diverse fish species that need to be taken into account. We've got the sturgeons, which can grow up to 4.5 meters long. So there's no ready-to-use solution for that fish passage restoration there. And we can't really copy or paste other experiences, for example, from the Rhine River. So it's very much focused solution. So we decided on a classic stepped approach. So the concept, design, build, monitor. But it's very interdisciplinary, as you can saw with the biological and the engineering aspects. This is to ensure project success. So we envisage that this project will evolve in the way that basically is from the feasibility study, detailed design can commence on Iron Gate 2, which is the lowermost dam. That can lead to construction, but in parallel, detailed design on Iron Gates 1 can go ahead. And with this type of sort of sequenced approach, we will build up knowledge over the project and the gained experience can be sort of translated into the next project phases. But as you can see from the time frame down at the bottom, we're quite a bit away until we'll see fish passing the Iron Gates. And with that, I'll pass over to Wilco.
Yes, thank you, Mark. I will tell something about the other two projects, the Fish Migration River and the Kierharingvliet, on behalf of the province of Friesland and Rijkswaterstaat. Next slide, please. Mark will continue clicking. First, we zoom a little out. We now move over from the Danube to the Rhine and Meuse catchments, and here's a view of the Netherlands from the sea. And what really stands out now is that the Netherlands is a big delta of the rivers Rhine and Meuse, amongst others. And in the Netherlands, we are actually managing the water already for centuries. And as a result, half the country is currently below sea level. Many estuaries, rivers and lakes are blocked with dams, weirs and sluices because of the managing, of course. That's for flood protection and discharge control. But since a few decades, there is more nature-included management. And for example, the Room of the River projects. And there's also now a lot of measures to reopen the estuaries. On the right-hand side, you see the three largest projects, the Fish Migration River in the north, the Kierharingvliet in the southwest, and the Markerwadde in the middle, which is actually a habitat restoration project of almost 2,000 acres. But in this presentation, I will tell a bit more on the connectivity measures, being the Fish Migration River and the Kier. Yeah. First, we go to the Fish Migration River. This is a bit more about the location. The Afsluitdijk was built in 1932 and blocked a large part of the shallow coastal sea called the Zuiderzee. This resulted in a very large freshwater lake called the IJsselmeer, because the river IJssel still flows into it. The discharge of the IJssel, which is actually a river Rhine branch, flows into the sea through the lake via two major discharge sluice complexes, which is actually one-way traffic. It's for water and as well for fish, due to the flow conditions. And one of the effects of the dam was the blockage of fish migration routes of mainly diadromous species like Atlantic salmon and European eel. Yeah. Here you can see the closure of the last opening. So this is 1933, I think, last opening in the dike. And the effect is clearly visible on the left. The closure of the Zuiderzee has brought us a lot of prosperity, of course, such as shipping and freshwater supplies. But it also had an enormous ecological impact. As you can see, the intertidal areas of the UNESCO World Heritage Waddenzee, which once extended all the way to Amsterdam, on the north side, and on the south side, you now see the Lake IJsselmeer with algal blooms in summer. The last thing, the algal blooms, that's already improved a lot last decades due to water quality measures, but the former migration routes are still blocked. The blue arrow indicates the location of the fish migration river connected to the main deep channel in the Waddenzee. Next slide. A bit of about project ambition. The aim of the fish migration river is to eliminate the fish migration bottleneck at sluice complex Cornwerder Zand. That's on the east part of the Afsluitdijk, and thereby contribute to a large scale so-called swimway between the open sea and the Rhine catchment. At the moment, there are discharge sluices and a shipping lock at Cornwerder Zand, and a third route will be added soon, and that is called the fish migration river. So the ambition is to restore fish migration routes of long distance migrants, such as sea trout and salmon. And there are still populations of these species. On the right hand, you see a sea trout caught in the River Vecht last year, which is a tributary to the Rhine, to the River IJssel. Please click. Yeah, the target species actually form a much larger group. These species all have their own specific migration behavior when they arrive at Cornwerder Zand, depending on where they are in their life cycle. And therefore we aim to restore estuarine conditions with tidal influence as much as possible. For example, to facilitate selective tidal stream transport for small species or juveniles of larger species like European eel. What is then actually a fish migration river? Well, on the left-hand side, you see an impression of how it's going to look like from a bird-sized perspective. We're going to build a 4 kilometer long river. Actually, that's what we call it, a river with open connection to the sea and the lake 24/7, or at least as much as possible. Of course, as always, can be incidents that needs to close, but we really aim at 24/7 open. And there are different zones in the fish migration river. We have two entrances on the north with an intertidal-like zone and a bird island. There's an open culvert in the dike, a brackish connection zone with two channels just south of the dike, and there's the bendy area to overcome the headrop to the lake. And here are some impressions. Here you see an impression of the entrances and the intertidal area with the bird island, which will fall dry for birds to feed on with low tide. And here's an impression of the culverts, so the hole in the dike, as we call it. And I will show a picture of the actual building later for scale. Yeah, a lot of engineering, modeling, and testing was carried out the last years. Time is too short to show everything, but here's a simulation of the freshwater attraction flow from the discharge sluices in the marine waters of the Waddenzee. So here you see the effect of it. And the next one, the one you're seeing now, is a simulation of the cell line gradient in the longitudinal cross section, which moves with the tide as a breeding system. So here you can really see the salt flowing in and flowing out again with the tide. Yeah, and something about the process. This project really was a bottom-up process with an initiators group which financed a small feasibility study to start with. This was subsequently picked up by the province of Friesland, who adopted the project. And a lot of research modeling and engineering followed as a kind of an iterative process. And there were also several international expert sessions to check and feed the design process. The total building costs are around 55 million to give you an impression of the project size. And we now really started. So that's a big hooray. I'm presenting now for the project for almost 8 years. And this is actually the very first presentation with building pictures in it. So what you see here is the construction of the open culvert. And so this gives an impression of the scale. Yes, then the next one, implementing the Kier-Haringvliet, another entrance to the Rhine catchment. To understand the role of the Haringvliet locks, we must zoom out again. And here on the map on the left that you already have seen, we see the international rivers Rhine and Meuse, the green and the orange catchments, and they flow into the North Sea via Lake Haringvliet and the Haringvliet Dam. On the picture right, you see the Atlantic salmon on its way to spawn. The Haringvliet is one of the main entrances of the Rhine and Meuse estuaries and the gate to the spawning sites upstream of multiple species. The salmon migrate through the Netherlands mostly to spawning sites in Germany. Now we zoom in a little bit to the Haringvliet locks or the dam, one of the famous delta works. The locks have two important functions, protecting the Netherlands against flooding from the sea and discharging river water into the North Sea. Behind the dam is now a freshwater lake called Haringvliet, a former sea arm which had tidal influence and was a major site for herring, hence its name. Haringvliet translates more or less into herring flow. The freshwater lake is now used for drinking water intake and water intake for agricultural irrigation. Yeah, and then the sluices itself. The sluices in the dam, they cover almost a kilometer and consists of 17 gates, which are 58 meters in length each. And here's a cross section. It consists of two gates per sluice for safety, one on the seaside and one on the riverside. You can see the road surface and cars on top for reference. Size reference. In normal operation, the sluices are closed when the seawater level is higher than the water level inland. When there is low water on the seaside, excess river water can be discharged to the sea. Like the situation at the Afsluitdijk, the dam altered the conditions inland. So the brackish sea arm with tidal conditions changed into a freshwater lake with a fixed water level, and migration routes were again blocked. Because the Netherlands functions as a migration corridor for some species like the Atlantic salmon, there was a call for reopening the system by countries more upstream in the Rhine catchments. And of course, the simple solution was to open the gates, but this was not so simple. So this process took decades, actually. It was very challenging. Around 2011, the Dutch government stopped the project because of the freshwater interests for drinking water purposes and agriculture. Alternatives were investigated, but the conclusion was that reopening was the best in the best interest of long distance migrants like the salmon. The countries of the Upper Rhine also insisted on this, so opening the gates. Ultimately, agreements were made that the effects on fresh water would be compensated, and with that decision, the project could finally start. The compensation measures, they consisted of moving the intake points for fresh water to the east. The costs were around 70 million euros. As a result, approximately 12 kilometers of the Haringvliet is now allowed to have salt intrusion. So that's the red area on the map. And this provided the space needed to open the gates partially. And here you see the results of many, many years. This is the first time marine waters entered the Haringvliet again, at least at a pretty large scale. Although it seems an apparently simple action to open the floodgates, there's more to it. Moving the freshwater intake points provide the needed space, but in practice, that space is still very limited. So we started small and we'll increase the opening as we know more about salt distribution through the lake and about fish migration. And the goal is eventually to be able to open the sluices as much as possible within the given space. This process we call learning by doing. And last year, the sluices were opened 82% of the tides. And the opening time varies between 15 minutes and 1.5 hours. And the sluices now were open 1,200 times since the beginning. Yeah, and here's another couple of impressive pictures in which you see the seawater flowing inland. So this is already a larger scale than the very first opening of one sluice. So the next step is to optimize and to test several protocols. There are a lot of parameters to vary with, like the number of gates, opening height, opening time, timing during the year, et cetera, and the possibilities are endless. Because not much is known of fish migration in estuarine conditions, this is a matter of testing and monitoring. And monitoring also already started. In spring 2020, monitoring was carried out to find out the first results. And during 7 opening times, an estimated 2.6 million fish entered the herring fleet. And 23 species were caught. And not surprisingly, maybe the herring being dominant in numbers. Almost 70%. And also the other species like flounder, smelt, and glass eel were caught. And in the lake itself, we already see that flounder has clearly increased in presence. Results on the long distance migrants, such as salmon, sea trout, and North Sea Houting and sea lamprey will follow soon.
Wilco?
Yeah?
Also, at the end, already at the in your spare time.
Yes, I'm at my last slide, actually.
Okay.
thank you, Katja. The very last slide with some concluding remarks about what we noticed in all three projects. These large-scale complex projects are one of a kind because of project-specific issues. So replicating is very difficult in these complex and large-scale projects. And moreover, due to the high impact, these kind of projects always are politically sensitive, and there are a lot of stakeholder interests. So therefore, you really need a tailored process for each project. Last remark that we want to make is that a certain momentum is needed to be able to take action and start with the project, and that you need a very long breath. So that was our presentation. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Wilco. Thank you, Mark, for these views on this very impressive project going on. Today, later on in the breakout session, there will be the project leader of the Fish Migration River, Erik Bruinslot. So if you want to meet him, go there. And tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock at our local time, you can meet Koen Bortel, who's the project leader of the Haring Fleet. We still have a bit of time for questions, and again, the question master, Ruben.
Thanks, Katja. there's questions for Mark. One concerns the costs of the Iron Gate fish passage facilities. I believe they must have been quite costly.
We don't know yet.
You don't know yet?
This is one of the main questions. We don't even know how many fishways we need. It could be several. It could be sort of downstream protection measures or practices. We don't know. This is the exact tasks of the feasibility study that's basically just started.
And are you building the fishways with sturgeon in mind? They should be passable for sturgeon,
yep.
For fully grown sturgeon.
Exactly. So that is increased size, definitely.
Yeah. Is there anything that you can elaborate on? Whether the fish passage facilities just scales disproportionately with the size of the fish that goes through? Is it just everything is bigger, or is there?
No, I think what we know from now and from the literature study, which was really, really useful, is that sturgeons are a completely different fish that we've normally been dealing with sort of in the Rhine system or in other European countries. They're very strong swimmers, but they are quite lazy. They tend to linger on the bottom of the river. That can be very deep. The tracking that we've seen or done actually shows that they're in depths of 6 to 9 meters, even sometimes. Picking that up in a fish pass entrance will be difficult. And that's why we're putting so much effort into this 3D modeling, 3D telemetry to actually find where do they actually sort of arrive at the barriers? Do they actually come to the spaces we normally would assume they come to, right to the turbulences? It might be that they're actually basically a bit back and we need several entrances. All that is sort of the focus of this feasibility study and especially the telemetry works that we'll be doing.
Are you sizing the fish passage with the native or with the historical reported sturgeon sizes in mind, or with like more like the ones that are contemporarily
I showed there's four sturgeon species there. There's two that have actually been extinct. There's quite a bit of conservation measures going on, so that will be aligned. The target species or size that are to be set will be basically also that needs to be worked out and refined in the feasibility study. But then it's sort of sizing, as we typically do nowadays, is sizing the fish to the largest species, but to the weakest swimmer. So looking at head drops, for example, in pool type fish passes or flow velocities, that's the focus that the approach will be typically taking. If it's a normal pool type or bypass, might be different, for example, for fish elevators could be an option, mm-hmm. for example. As
okay.
Well.
Thank you very much. I believe we run out of time. Is that correct?
Yeah. Okay, we are.
Questions for Wilco. We'll have to wait until our question and answer session. Please stay online for that. And we keep collecting your questions in the question and answer chat, in the question and answer box. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ruben. Thank you, Mark and Wilco. See you in
Thank
a
you.
Moment. But now Bye. We got Jason waiting for us.
Hi.
Are you there?
I am. Hopefully you can hear me and see me.
Yeah. Now I can see you. So please tell us, where are you?
I'm in Worcester in UK, which is Midlands. Hopefully you're going to see zooming in on this.
Yeah, there are.
Little
there
jar. Zooming in. Yep. So I'm on the River Severn, UK's longest river. I'm here at the end of what's been quite a challenging 2 or 3 years in constructing a few fish passes. The project itself is called Unlocking the Severn. I've got two parts of this today. Because it's really noisy outside near the pass, I'll just talk a little bit inside. I'll show you the pass outside and I'll take you downstairs into the viewing gallery. I'll try to stick to 5 or 6 minutes. So the project is Unlocking the Severn. It's to construct four fish passes on the River Severn and two partial weir removals on the River Tee. And the target species is shad, particularly the Thwaite shad. It's a partnership project that's only been possible because of the amazing support of the partners, Environment Agency, Canal River Trust, Severn Rivers Trust and Natural England, with amazing support from the EU Life Programme at over €6,000 and our National Lottery Heritage Fund at just close to £11 million. It's been an amazing culmination of about 7 or 8 years work. And we have got to the stage now where while we haven't finished one of the fish passes, which we were delayed from the floods last year, we've finished three of them. And I'm at the biggest now, so I'm going to try and flip my camera and show you and talk you through this actual slot. It is quite bright here, so hopefully you'll be able to see.
Yeah, we can see
Great.
It.
So we're at Diglis. This is our first one. The shad historically have only been able to make it to the weir that hopefully you can just make out. It's a 2 meter change in water level. And this fish pass has been designed to accommodate, you know, the weakest link of the shad. It's 100 meters long, it's 8 meters wide, and it was 8 meters deep when we started to construct it. And what you can see hopefully is a central concrete series of pools that lift the water from downstream of the weir to upstream in pools of 20 centimetres, 200 mil, which gets us up that 2 metre change. It then moves round at a right angle to take the water off the river and go on upstream. We have two big water control structures just below me that we can use to turn off the water when we need to get into the channel for maintenance.
Yeah.
And the unique thing here is the engagement that we want to do. We've constructed an underwater viewing gallery, which I'll take you down to in a minute. But what I hope we can see is the channel being narrowed down by that screen to a 500 millimeter channel that is squeezed between the big window and some backlights.
So during the migration season of May and June, where the shad come off the Irish Sea and the estuary into the fish pass, every fish, including the shad and other species, get funneled into that gap to come past the window. Two reasons for that. One is to monitor the population, not just of shad, but salmon, sea and river lampreys, and eels over time, but also to engage people. I'm going to go down now. Hopefully,
yes,
we transition into the dark.
We still down have into a minute.
Down into the depths of the bunker.
Oh, this is really great having this tour.
So this will be the route for all our members of the public. We have had some salmon through today, but we'll have to see because they obviously don't come on command. And there we have our windows.
Wow.
So that window is 2.5 meters tall and 2 meters wide.
Yep.
As I mentioned, the water flow through there is about 500 mil to the backlighting panels. So every fish that's come up over the last couple of months since we got the water in has had to come through here. It's been really amazing. It's been a real eye opener and it's so far exceeded expectations. I guess I've got to caveat that with we've had a really peculiar May. It's been the fourth wettest May on record in the UK and the wettest in Wales, where most of the water in the River Severn comes from. So it really interfered with our monitoring and watching of the shad migration this year. But saying that, we've had 19 species through already, including the shad, salmon, river and sea lamprey, eels, barbel, chub, lots of silverfish like dace and roach, that kind of stuff, pike, perch. So far it's been really successful. Colleagues at the Environment Agency in Charles may be on the line, has been leading the scientific research, which started out as citizen science and monitoring further downstream, where you can view the fish on a notch over a whiteboard. We've now kind of elevated that to in here. We're sort of trialing this camera that you can hopefully just make out, which is permanently watching the window. It's motion sensitive and takes little video clips of fish as they come through. And the hope is this bit of kit will be developed with a company I understand is in the Netherlands. It'll be programmed to recognize the silhouettes of the different species of fish. And then every month we'll get a download from the software that will tell us the species, the date, the time, the numbers, which will be an amazing, amazing research purpose, research background for us to see, shows the life, hopefully over the years, the increase in the shad population over 5 to 10 years. And it will also provide us a great time to bring people down here. So if we know fish move at the moment, indicatively more in the afternoon, with the time we'll bring more people down here. We are going to have some more interpretation and an audio-visual experience. Big TV on the wall with all clips of previous fish we've seen, just in case you don't see anything when you're down here. And it will be here for years and years to come. So while we've finished the construction of this fish pass, this is going to be here for generations. And it's going to provide a really unique opportunity for members of the public to view wild fish.
Jason, it is really, really great, but we have to stop here because but Herman has one burning question, and of course if Herman has a question then ahead.
It's not me, but it's Autier Vincent, maybe Vincent Autier. He is asking, there are two windows and there's one smaller one. What's the smaller one used for? Why is there
the smaller one? Was originally planned to be a door to get to, when we de-water, to get in to clean the window, which needs to be done every week. We've found an alternative way, so we didn't have to have the flood risk and the ingress of water. We turned it into a window. And this one's great because there's no light. This is natural light coming through, and you often get the fish glimpsing in this window before they swim over to the big window. So it's actually a really great addition to the gallery.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. This is really helpful. This is also adaptive, this design. So thank you, Jason, for showing us around in this beautiful surrounding, and it's open to the public. So I hope many people who are now in the webinar will be able to visit it. Oh, it's good to see you again. So thank you, Jason.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye.
And now we go to another commercial break. So again, we thank our sponsors for enabling us to see all these parts of the world where fish is migrating.
Princeton Hydro has designed over 100 dam removals in the northeastern United States, including the largest dam removal in New Jersey. On Earth Day, just weeks after the Columbia Dam was removed, American shad returned upstream to their native spawning grounds for the first time in over 100 years.
At Low-Tech, we've been advancing wildlife science for more than 35 years. Our receivers are trusted by researchers around the globe for any number of study applications. Our enhanced WHS-4350 acoustic receiver is JSATS compatible and provides approved detection range. Our new SRX-1200 receiver offers advanced features to trust the reliability of our previous generations. Wherever your species moves, make sure you have the right equipment for your study, for our experience to work for you.
Hi, I'm Warren from Oregon RFID. We design and manufacture half-duplex pit tag readers. We also provide technical support to help you set up and maintain your own site. During a break, we invite you to take a look at our new single and multiple antenna readers to see the many unique features. Our U.S. website is OregonRFID.com, and our European friends can visit us at OregonRFID.eu. Enjoy the conference, and we hope to see you in person at the next one.
Welcome back. So this is the wrapping up, and we will share the results of the poll with you, and then we ask the three presenters of today to respond to that. But Ruben will show the first result.
That is correct. Let me just share my screen again. This always takes a second. There we go. I hope everyone can see it. You can see it. Yeah, that looks just right.
I can see it. Yeah.
Katja, any thoughts
on this? But I would like to have the presenters in. So
they're not there.
They're not there.
Tommy.
Yeah, exactly. You're Paul. Paul, please. What is your first impression if you look at this outcome of this work?
Well, I thought the poll was really exciting, and it was really well done in terms of the visualization. I'm not totally surprised by barrier removal and dam removal being very high based on who the audience is. I would have liked to have seen beavers there, certainly. a little small word of full connectivity, so we're not just focusing on the bias of longitudinal connectivity.
Okay, thank you, Paul. And Mark, what's your first impression looking at this word cloud?
Yeah, very much the same. We know Paul presented the results from AMBER. We know from previous projects in Germany, about 20-25% of the barriers are just obsolete. But there's sort of not sort of big willingness to take them all out. The funding is a problem, but you can't always do it. That's the problem. So there's many barriers there that serve certain purposes, and you need different solutions for those. So I'm very much in favor to go for barrier removal in a first sense, if that's possible. That's the best way to go. But that, as I say, it's not always possible.
Okay, thank you. And Anna, if you look at the word clouds and within your field of expertise, turbulence, is there anything you would like to share with us?
Well, I don't think I can add much more than what Paul and Mark, they said. Well, it's not a surprise for me as well that barrier removal and air removal are like the big words here. And I do agree with Paul that we also need to look into the lateral connectivity and not only focus on longitudinal connectivity. It's really very important. If we should focus on beavers, yeah, in fact, it's funny. I do have a colleague of mine that is always talking about beavers. So it was nice to hear the beavers here as well in this context. And I also agree with Mark that sometimes like remove barriers is not the possible solution. So we also have to look into other things. And I think here is also where maybe my presentation can come is like trying to come to this all theoretical part and trying to put our hands on the field and on the work and come and create like new solutions and trying to adapt the other ones that we see that are not working so well. So I think it should be like a combination of everything.
Okay, thank you. And I've been to fish specialist conferences before, and I've seen also presentation that barrier removal or dam removal has also certain drawbacks, like giving space to invasive species or having an impact on the morphology of the upper parts of the river. Do we have similar experiences? Paul or Mark or yep. Anna?
Biggest yep. problem in Germany that we always face in here is groundwater level changes near the rivers. Because we've got lots of structures, buildings, houses quite close to the rivers. That's a problem that we always hear, or even sort of the natural, the riverine vegetation changing due to the improvements. Not many conservation authorities are actually in favor of developing. They're more into conserving what's there. That's the really interesting conflict that we see.
Yeah, okay, Paul?
Yeah, just to add to that, I think the issue of invasive species is a really good one. Also, protection of genetics of certain stocks. So some of the upper headwater dams might be providing refuge for stocks of brown trout, for example, that are the native. And particularly if you have an issue with stocking, it's trying to protect those particular stocks. I think the other thing is that barrier removal can be a waste of money if it's not done right. So the issue that we have this high density of barriers and they're all interconnected, there's no point moving one dam if there's another dam downstream that's blocking the movement of salmon or whatever you're interested in. So it's the fact that you need to think of these dams not in an isolated manner, but as a network, and then have a good plan to actually remove them in sequence.
Okay, so it's really thinking ahead before you start one thing and doing the other.
Yeah. Can I actually jump in on that? Because this is exactly what we discussed earlier when we discussed the margin against concept, right? It's not enough to just remove a tiny little dam somewhere when there's so much going on downstream that that the ecological effect just remains negligible. We need to have a holistic picture.
We do, but the other difficulty we have is the time scale in which to do it. So like I said, many dams have been put there over hundreds of years. Maybe we can't take them all out in one go. There's just not the funding available to do that. So we need to have a long-term strategy, use these optimization models, and then take them out. Often what the Environment Agency in the UK doing is very opportunistic. It's when a landowner says, yes, I'm interested in doing this. At the same time, there's some funding available. So you've got to play within the pragmatic realms that we're storing our rivers in.
Yeah, and another question referring to that, and maybe you, that is that we see this increase in summer droughts in Northwestern Europe, I guess also in Southern Europe. Should that be taken into account in our planning of dam removal? Mark, maybe you would like to
I've experience with this type of subject with regards to fish pass design, because that's actually changing the design criteria as well. I had one project in the Netherlands where we projected water level and discharge changes mainly due to river incision, not so much climate change. But what we're seeing now, 2 years after realization, that due to the summer droughts, we're already down almost close to the 50-year projected water levels that we included in the design, and that those are occurring basically every year now already. So yes, definitely a thing that we need to think of, both in dam removal, barrier removal, but also in fishway design.
Yeah, okay, thank you. We have still two questions or two outcomes of the poll. So I think it's wise to go to the next one.
Sure.
Okay. Time is flying.
Katja, could I just add something and bring something here to the table as well? Regarding to the last two questions. So regarding to the looking into the invasive species, and I agree with both Paul and Mark as well, again. But I also like to bring, like, that's also important that we think also in another topic that is very important here in Norway, that escapement of fish from fish farms. And that has like a very strong impact on the wild populations. And it's something like, yeah, some of these solutions can also help us to control that. You know, it's something that sometimes doesn't appear so much in some countries. And here, for instance, in Norway, it's like a big problem. Some of the wild populations of salmon are starting to decrease because of that, because they have like some parasites and et cetera, and then it becomes very bad for the entire system. So yeah, so that's just something that I also think will be important to think. And even like when we just assume about dam removal, then there's also this aspect to have in consideration. Sometimes it's not even possible because of that.
Yeah, that's a good point, Anna, also because there is this stimulation of blue growth. Eh? So we are expecting more salmon being raised and then more to be escaped properly with all the problems. Yeah, that is a very good addition, Anna. Thank you for that. Yeah, if we go to this outcome of the poll, the sea to source perspective. So there is a kind of a change from fully disagree to fully agree. We cannot ask the people who put in fully disagree, because we cannot invite them into the Zoom. But do you have any idea? So I'm now asking you to go in the head of someone else. What might be a reason to fully disagree? This is a difficult one. I understand that maybe you would like to give it a go.
Okay, can I give it a try, Katja?
Yes, please.
Yeah, of course, it's super good to have a plan. That's one. And a plan needs a certain approach. So if you take the sea to source approach, that's great. But what we also see in quite a lot of projects is that this is also misused, actually. And that dam owners or water authorities or governments or private owners, whoever it may be, say, hey, it's not worth investing time and money in a fishway, for example, at my dam, because there's three more dams downstream that are not yet possible for fish. And then I could imagine that people say, I fully don't agree with this approach, because the most expensive and most complex projects are downstream, even in the estuaries. What we just presented, for example, the Kier and the Fish Migration River, those are often last in the line because they're the most complex. So if you follow that reasoning, then I can imagine that people say, yeah, I don't agree, because I want to, of course, we need a plan for the whole catchment, but wherever you have an opportunity, take it, whenever it's in the upper, the middle, or the lower region of the river.
Okay, thank you, Wilco. Any other comments on this by the others? Mark, please.
Yeah, we're just thinking who could have answered like that. I attended a seminar last week in Austria on fish protection. And for example, I was just thinking, so for example, for the Austrian people, basically all of the fish species that are in Austria are potamodromous, so they're not diadromous species. So they wouldn't need to take such an approach because they're basically looking at landlocked species. That could be a reason for that full disagree.
Okay, thank you. And then we're already going to switch to the last one.
All right, let's see it. There we go.
So have a look. The most obvious thing is the 63%, eh? I don't know. Then I ask first, so we got four guests here. So do you know? I will start with Wilco.
Well, I think in the Netherlands we have a lot of we have a bit of the let's do it or learning by doing approach. And Mark, I think he will agree because we did a project of a very large fishway in the Netherlands, and it only took, I think it was 1.5 years. And Mark said, well, in Germany this would have taken maybe not decades, but many more years. but the side effect that you have then is that sometimes you need to, of course you need to monitor those fish waste, and then you recognize, hey, this is not working exactly how we thought it would. And that's not per se very bad if you do the monitoring and the check and then take action and maybe modify it or make it work and optimize it. So, but I'm pretty sure that there's quite a lot of fishways which are not working exactly as how they were designed. But again, if you monitor and optimize them, that might not be an issue and is also a certain approach.
Okay, thank you, Wilco. I think we had a inventory in the Netherlands and it was also not a nice outcome. If I remember correctly, but maybe Herman can send the link around. Anna, do you have a comment on this?
Like speaking for Norway here, like most of the fishways have been designed using like the design criteria for salmonids. And in fact, salmon is the king species here in Norway, but we do have more species than salmon. So it ends up that most of them don't work properly, and that is something now that Norwegian authorities are looking at, is trying to retrofitting these designs and these fishways, looking more to other species with lower jumping capacity and more like the species that we find like more inland rivers. So yeah, it does work if we look more into salmon and trout, but yeah, most of them, they don't work very well. So that's a kind of a problem in Norway, in fact.
Okay, yeah, what a pity to hear. Thank you, Anna. Mark?
Well, we had an inventory. We did an inventory about 10 years ago in Germany, and we found exactly sort of that most of them didn't work. Actually, the attraction was the problem, finding the entrances. So that's why we developed a guideline with a completely different approach, looking at basically attraction, passage, and the operation. And we developed a guideline that was for all fish species in a certain river region, and you design the fishway according to that. And basically during implementation, if you design the fishway according to those specs, then it should be working fine. It doesn't really need an effectiveness check. It is done nevertheless, but we're also seeing different results in different years. So it's sometimes somewhat problematic, and I assume Paul could talk on that, sort of comparing the results of effectiveness checks over different years, because even if you do it with the same methodology, you don't get the same results every year, they're not the same.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Paul?
Yeah, I think in that question, it's an interesting question. The word work, what do we mean by work? How do we evaluate it? Yeah. Often that's attraction efficiency, passage efficiency, delay. You don't tend to get that information in the design specifications. What is the expectation in terms of delay, passage efficiency, attraction efficiency for different fish species? So actually, we're on a losing wicket in many ways because we don't know what we're working to achieve. But the objectives are very fuzzy. So I think one of the issues is we have very little cases where we've gone and done the robust telemetry studies needed to actually assess the effectiveness of many of these fishways. So I would certainly be in that 63, I don't know, grouping.
Okay, thank you, Paul. It's already time to close this this part of the webinar. So what is left is that there will be, after this, there will be network sessions and demonstrations, and you will be sent a link. I would like to thank especially Ruben as thank being you, the master of everything. He did a pretty good job, and there is a technical staff which you don't see, but they also made things work very smoothly. So I will wrap it up, and there will be an announcement of the Fish Species Conference of next year, and Herman will really close it up. And for those who will join tomorrow at 6 o'clock, we will be back 6 o'clock in the morning, local time. Hope to see you then again. And thank you again for all your contributions, speakers and guests in the field.
Thank you, Katja. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. That was quick.
The Columbia River flows through mountains, deserts, and farmland in the Pacific Northwest corner of the United States. The Columbia River Basin is best known for its salmon, lamprey, and sturgeon, and the challenge to support their long migrations through a river system that has been altered significantly by humans. Its tributaries, the Snake and Yakima Rivers, converge in the Tri-Cities of Washington State. That's the location for the 2022 Fish Passage Conference. Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, located next to the last free-flowing stretch of the Columbia, will host the International Conference on River Connectivity. Join us as we explore innovation for next-generation fish passage technology. See advanced research being done at the laboratory and technology being tested in nearby rivers. Our organizing team includes regional research institutions, hydropower management groups, and Native American tribes. The conference will focus on global innovations in upstream and downstream fish passage. How can we help fish to get to where they are going while considering environmental justice and equity aspects of river connectivity? You'll hear about next-generation turbine design and new ways to monitor fish behavior. Approaches include computer and field-based research and development that aims to improve river connectivity. Fish Passage 2022 will offer an online experience for those who can't join us in person. Either way, you'll have the opportunity to connect with partners pushing the boundaries of fish passage technology and policy to improve river connectivity around the world.
Hello, everybody. Hey, thanks for listening in today. We're going to end with breakout groups, and we're going to have a special chat meeting, social meeting. So don't go away yet. Mark, can you start up the presentation, perhaps? While he is starting up the presentation, I have this award, the Happy Fish Award. Happy Fish is a symbol for open rivers and swimway. And I want to give this to our moderator of today, Katja. Katja, this is for you. Thank you very much for moderating.
Thank you.
All right. Our foundation, World Fish Migration Foundation, is started. We started 5 years, 6 years ago to save migratory fish in rivers. And we want to thank the presenters, the sponsors, and also the Fish Passage Steering Group and the advisory group for helping us making this happen. And what we want to do as a foundation is to celebrate the success stories which are out there here at the Haring Fleet, the fish migration river, the dam removals. And we want to celebrate these challenges together and open up rivers around the world. And we are doing this by an event that you might know already, the World Fish Migration Day. And we want to connect fish, rivers, and people by hosting events. And next year, there will be another event, the fifth one, and it's a special edition. And on May 21, we're going to do it again. We will have art events, we will have outreach events. Hopefully the corona will be gone and we can be out again with our families. So let's hope that happens. And I want to invite you to join and to join the campaign, the Break Free campaign. And we have asked Jeremy Waite from the River Monsters program to have us make a special announcement for the World Fish Migration Day. And yeah, and we are starting today with our new website, the World Fish Migration Day website, and Jeremy is going to announce it.
Hello, because most of the fish that need to travel up and down rivers in order to feed or to breed do so out of sight of humans, they need us to highlight the problems that they can face and also the solutions to those problems. And that's exactly what we're going to be doing on the next World Fish Migration Day. Events are going to range all the way from fish art competitions right the way to full-blown removal of dams, or you can organise your own event. So note the date in your diary. It's 21st of May 2022. See you there. Hello.
All right. Another one. Now we're gonna close down and close off, and we're gonna open a couple of breakout groups. Mike will share a couple of links in the chat so that you can follow. And the breakout groups are there for the sponsors. We have a breakout group for our own foundation, but take a look. The Fish Migration River Project will be there. The company FishLift from the Netherlands. And Biomark, and we have something else as well, which you, if you would like to socialize, you'd like to go to a cafe, a digital cafe, we have opened, next slide, Mark. We've opened a special special chat networking session, and we are also sharing that link in the chat. So if you want to go to the cafe, have a beer with us or another drink, you're free to come and enjoy. See you later. Thank you.